Hi, everyone. My name is Kiersten Formoso. I am a PhD candidate at the University of Southern California and the Natural History Museum of LA County. And I am a vertebrate paleontologist who studies how land animals evolved to become swimming animals and how animals swim in general. I loved the first Avatar, and I've been waiting so long for Avatar 2 to come out. And the second trailer is finally here. And I'm so excited to be in a position today to be able to scientifically break down the trailer. And let's get started with that. All right, so the first thing we're going to talk about in this trailer is this beautiful shot of these ikran and their riders flying over this sea of Pandora. You can see that there are these aquatic aliens in there that look very fish-like, even like the fossil armored fish, Dunkleosis. And I noticed, as someone who studies how they swim, that beautiful waveform motion, shark-like locomotion that they're swimming with, where a wave is passed down from the body, mostly starting at kind of like the center of the animal, and then the tail is undulating side to side for the animals to propel themselves. So that's the first thing I notice, and it's just absolutely beautiful. All right, so this next really beautiful scene we're going to talk about, of course, is the alien swimming up to the reef and smiling underwater. Firstly, I love this scene because it shows off just the beauty of this new movie. I mean, the detail, it's absolutely phenomenal. For me, I'm always looking at the animals, and so I'm here looking at the swimming creatures in the background, which are kind of swimming with a ray-like locomotion, so kind of like a flapping of their underwater hydrofoil. So hydrofoil is just a kind of a fancy way of essentially saying a flipper, so a propulsive apparatus or a limb that's used to maneuver or propel an animal in an aquatic environment. And so I'm definitely excited to see more of the kind of smaller reef-based creatures of this world. But honestly, the creature design is just out of this world, just top-notch. And I'm so, so excited for all of this. Okay, so this next part of the trailer made me absolutely lose my mind because this Navi is riding an alien plesiosaur, essentially, and I'm so here for this. So plesiosaurs are the kind of four equal size flipper, short body, longish necks for some of them. Some of them had short necks and big heads like pliosaurs, but they're these four equal size flipper propelling marine reptiles that lived during the Mesozoic, the same time as the dinosaurs. They're an animal that's in my study group. They're very near and dear to my heart because biomechanically and aquatically, they're so cool. And to see the creative team at Avatar take clear inspiration from plesiosaurs of our planet, of our reality, of our natural history, it's just so cool to see. And this would be me if I was in this world, if I was a Navi or if I was a me with an avatar, this would be my vacation. I would pay to ride underwater this plesiosaur. And so of course, let's talk about the biology of it. These animals on Pandora, with the exception of the Navi, assuming they lost their limbs, ancestrally have six limbs. So this plesiosaur, you can actually see six little paddles when it's swimming from what I counted. Or at least kind of the kind of fins on the front, the second fins on the back that are actually moving. And I believe there's a third pair back there. So that would lead to the sixth limb somewhere. Either way, it's really, really neat morphology. And I wonder if in this world, like on Earth, if plesiosaurs, alien plesiosaurs actually evolved from terrestrial ancestors, given the way it looks. So fish that never evolved from terrestrial ancestors, of course, are not going to have limbs that turn back into fins. They're just going to have their fins. And there's a big morphology change that goes when you turn a land leg into a hydrofoil, an aquatic limb, an aquatic extension. And so, yeah, I love this animal. And I'm really, really excited to see this one the most, I think, for sure. And so this next scene is really, really beautiful. Here we have one of our Navi characters, kind of looks like Jake Sully, doesn't matter who it is, but it matters what they're reaching out to this beautiful Pandoran whale-like animal, just absolutely huge. It's got these gigantic pectoral fins. That's going to be the fins in the front. Not too dissimilar from like a humpback whale. Humpback whales have really, really big pectoral flippers compared to other whales, which is really, really interesting. And just this absolutely giant, gentle, probably slow-moving animal. I'd be curious in the actual movie to see if they're also eating kind of small things versus big things. I have a feeling they are probably eating small things because this animal is much bigger than this Navi character. And if it was dangerous, would probably eat them, but they're not doing that. So probably, again, a kind of convergent whale-like ecology. And in this next scene where we see one of our characters actually holding onto its fin while it's swimming, it has a very whale-like looking face. And so very clear inspiration from our living animals. And of course, it's worth mentioning that Navi are so much bigger than people, right? I think they're like, I would say 2.5 times the height of like an Earth human. And so if the Navi are really big and this whale alien looks really big compared to the Navi, that means these alien whales are probably decently bigger than our largest whales on our real planet. So blue whales and fin whales. So that's pretty cool. So alien giants, you love to see it. So I'm really excited about seeing these animals and what they mean for the story. All right, so this last specific clip of the trailer we're gonna talk about is with this amazing, amazing animal. And it's actually really cool that they saved it for like the last part. And that's going to be this clearly flying fish inspired alien creature here. And so this alien swimming animal has guard-like aspects. It has sturgeon-like aspects. Even honestly, kind of the long snout can be tons of different animals, including river dolphins, gharials, ichthyosaurs. So just absolute mega conglomeration of awesome, fast-moving aquatic animals, but definitely the flying fish, I think, gar aspect come through very heavily. And I have to give credit to Dr. Solomon David on Twitter for this amazing pun where he called this animal Gar Force One. And that's how he's going to be arriving at conferences from now on. And I totally get it. As a gar researcher, I would be so excited to see this animal, to see a gar be alien Pandorified and combined with a flying fish. So cool. Neat little detail of this scene actually is that when it's first coming out of the water, Jake's legs are kind of down over the animal like a regular horse mount. But in order for it to fly, he actually had to jump up on the animal to free the space for the wings. So the wings could actually fully come out and actually get some air propulsion there. So that's really, really nice attention to detail, is the kind of rider being cognizant of the anatomy of the animal that it is riding. And so whatever battle scene that this animal is going to be used for is going to be so cool. And I'm absolutely pumped to see how it is utilized in the movie. So yeah, woo. Okay, so now let's talk about swimming in these animals. So of course the sequel is titled Avatar, The Way of Water. That is a clear indication that this movie is gonna have a lot of focus on aquatic environments and the aquatic biology within it, as just summarized by some of the trailer clips. And so swimming is actually a really, really cool thing to bring to life in an alien world. And that's because water as an environment has very specific physics constraints that make animals have a physiology and locomotion and other biological aspects that actually fit the, again, the constraints of aquatic environments. And so with physics and locomotion, and so this is kind of the thing that I was focusing on the trailer because this is what I study how animals swim. So again, I study the evolution of land to sea primarily. So how animals that are secondarily aquatic, so animals like whales and seals and sea lions, and then extinct animals like ichthyosaurs, mosasaurs, and plesiosaurs, how they modified their limbs to be able to propel themselves in aquatic environments. And so there's really two main types of swimming. There's going to be axial swimming, where you're using your kind of body and tail and undulations in different directions in order to propel yourself through the water and generate thrust. And so in fish and reptiles, typically there's going to be lateral or side to side oscillations that are doing that. And then in animals like mammals, typically it's going to be up down oscillations like in manatees and whales. So some mammals actually are able to get lateral ones, like kind of smaller things like otter shrews and other kind of swimming rodents and or rather small swimming mammals. And so that's one way to swim, so axial swimming. And we clearly saw that in the trailer when they were first flying over, where you kind of saw those big shark-like animals. So they were generating waves that were going down the body laterally. So that's axial swimming. And the other way to swim is going to be what's called paraxial swimming or appendicular swimming. And so this is going to be where an animal is using its limbs to generate propulsion and thrust in order to swim through an aquatic environment, as opposed to using its limbs for, say, just maneuvering and turning and kind of more control-based stabilization of things. They're actually using the limbs to propel themselves through the water. Some animals that you know of that do this are going to be penguins, sea lions in particular. Seals actually do use their back legs to move through the water. And then a bunch of extinct animals like plesiosaurs. And so we saw the alien plesiosaur in this trailer using its flippers to propel itself. It had the kind of middle pair that was moving, and then it had the big back pair to propel itself quickly, and it probably had high maneuverability. Typically, things that swim with appendicular locomotion are really easily able to maneuver. A real sea lion can actually turn literally on a dime. They can experience about 5 G's of force in the water. So I expect similar efficiency in the animals of Pandora and their swimming. So yeah, that's kind of just a summary on the type of swimming that we see in animals on Earth and the type of swimming that is going to likely be seen on Pandora due to those constraints. So the other thing that really stood out to me in this trailer and just in thinking about it is just going to be honestly the sheer scale of these animals. The biggest animals that ever existed on planet Earth are aquatic animals. The first animals to ever get big in general are going to be Triassic ichthyosaurs after the end Permian extinction. Really cool recent publication that just came out about that, about how these giant ichthyosaurs were quick to evolve to large sizes, and they diversified very shortly after this extinction boundary. And so first animals to get massive on Earth were in aquatic environments, and then animals in the Mesozoic just also kept getting totally huge. And then of course the biggest animal that ever existed, which we have the privilege of living alongside, is alive today, is the blue whale. And so with that, with the knowledge of Earth's biology, that water allows things to get just absolutely huge, I have a feeling that we're going to see some absolutely magnificent gigantic creatures in Avatar 2. We already saw hints of it in the trailer with those kind of big whale-like creatures, but I wonder if they might go even larger because they totally have the ability to. Aquatic environments foster large sizes in tons of different types of animals. And I think given that the biology of Pandora is already larger than the biology of Earth, even though interestingly enough, it's like a smaller planet, or rather it's a moon of a big gas giant that it's near. I think the trailer might just be showing a little bit, and I hope we get kind of like the best for in the movie itself with just some behemoths, some ocean giants, literal sea monsters. So that's the other thing that kind of popped out to me with the new biology that we're seeing of Pandora. Okay, so my overall takeaway of the Avatar 2 trailer is that it's amazing, and I knew it was going to be amazing going into it. So the trailer first premiered ahead of the Doctor Strange Multiverse of Madness movie, which I went to see, but I'm not even exaggerating when I say that half the reason I went to see Doctor Strange movie was to see the Avatar 2 trailer, and I was probably the most excited one in the entire theater, but it's fine. I should be, because I'm a huge, huge Avatar fan. I literally love the movie, and so I have, big Avatar fan. And when I found out that the second one a while ago, and I learned that it was going to be focusing on the oceans of Pandora, my aquatic marine animal loving self was absolutely like crazy, like, oh my gosh, I cannot wait for this movie. And of course, it took so many years for it to actually come to fruition, but finally it is here. Avatar 2 is imminent. I am excited, I'm pumped, I am joyed. I probably watched the trailer 30 times, not even kidding. I'll just put it on in the background. But my overall takeaway is this is going to be a really, really cool movie. Clearly, the creative team behind it put a lot of effort into the science and the biology, truly. And that's just from like a light glimpse of the creatures and the biology of this new expansion, if you will, of our view of Pandora. And it's going to be great. And December can't come soon enough. I am anticipating no movie more this year than Avatar 2, The Way of Water. So, woo, I can't wait. All right, all, thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned a great deal about the biology or upcoming biology of the world of Avatar. And I hope you're even more excited about Avatar 2 now after watching this. I know I'm even more excited about telling it, talking about it with all of you. And if you'd like to know more about kind of these topics of marine things and aquatic things, be sure to follow me on my various social media, Twitter, Instagram, and Twitch, all at the same handle, @4morphology. And be sure to like this video and subscribe to the Alf Museum for more stories from the world of paleontology. Thanks and bye.